Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome to everybody online as well. We're going to start things off with a song. The first one is called Start a Fire. We'll have the lyrics up for all of the songs and invite you to please sing along with us.
Thank you, folks. Good morning, people of God.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome to all of you online and here in person on this Memorial Day weekend, and a little cold and rainy weekend. Thanks for being part of this Pentecost Sunday worship this morning. A couple of things to be aware of and remind you of between Mother's Day a few weeks ago and Father's Day coming up in June. We are raising money to build clean water wells in global communities that do not have access to clean water. Please consider honoring the mothers and fathers in your life with a gift, or anyone you would like to honor. Also, next Sunday, June 4th, bring all your loose change next Sunday for a noisy offering that will go toward our total that we raise. That would be helpful for next Sunday. And speaking of next Sunday, June 4th, it's a special day for all of us. So let's come together at 10 a.m. for a combined worship service. We'll be in the traditional worship space, all of us, including the band, and followed by our annual spring meeting to elect leaders and to consider our new mission and ministry plan beginning July 1st with the new fiscal year. And then let's all enjoy a picnic together with some special music, some games, and don't forget a cornhole tournament, okay? next Sunday, beginning at 10 a.m. And please get the word out, and we hope to see as many people here as possible next Sunday morning, starting at 10 a.m. Tomorrow is, of course, Memorial Day. I hope many of you get to enjoy a day off or some time off and maybe some time with family and friends. Remember, just a reminder, the church office will be closed. So as we begin this morning, I want to share with you a litany that was written by one of our members who passed away a little over a year and a half ago, Grace Brehm, wonderful teacher in the church, and she often would preach for folks, for pastors who were out both in Delaware, and then she moved here after retirement. She's written several books, and she had some thoughts on Pentecost. As we begin this morning, we'll use her litany and join along with me. In a quiet act of trust, to the presence that gives us life, to the reality that existed before earth was formed,
to the spirit that comes as fire to transform our lives and make them new.
Burn within us, God. Burn warm with love. Burn bright with joy.
Burn hot enough to turn ashes anything.
Burn hot enough to consume all that makes me doubt your power in me. Burn away our barriers to wholeness. Burn away our resistance to reformation and renewal. Burn away our limited thinking. Burn away whatever limits our creativity and vision that have been inbred by habitual thinking, by opinions of others, by seeming necessities that have become my masters. Turn my bondage to fear into nothing but smoke and dust, and teach me within the looseness of listening and the rhythm of trust. Amen. Let's stand and join together for our next song, shall we?
Join us at Singing Spirit.
Oh Lord, we will sing your praises.
by your presence, how we need you, God. How we need you, God.
Once again, happy Pentecost Sunday. Good to be together. Take a moment to turn and greet, welcome each other to worship. Say happy Pentecost to each other. Good to be together. Any children in the house? Come on up, Jim and Stephanie. Kids, come on up. If you aim, come on up and spend a couple minutes with Stephanie. She's got a good message for you this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Crank that thing on. There you go.
Hey, friends. Good morning. So, who remembers what the screen said? It's what Sunday? What's the word? Pentecost Sunday. Now, what does that mean? Don't worry. I'm still confused sometimes, too. It's okay. There's this cool book right here, The Day When God Made Church. Okay? I can't read this book because it's very long, but it's very good. This book is going to be in a kids' library that Kat and I are putting together for you guys. That will be open in the fall. So if anybody has any books they want to donate, we'll take them. So one thing about Pentecost is it's magical to me. What's this? What does a fan do? It blows air. Make sure I hit the right button. So how does it blow the air? The blades move around and around and around. Now, you can feel it, right? But you can't see it moving, can you? Well, I can see Ivy's hair moving, so I know it's doing something. Briggs, your hair's too short. Davis, your hair's too short. But we can feel it. Now, that's kind of like the Holy Spirit. We can't see the Holy Spirit, but we can feel it doing things. So we can see how the Holy Spirit moves through everybody, through the music, through the scriptures, through Pastor Jay's message, through hugs with our friends. We can't see it, but we know it's there. We know it's doing something. So what I want you guys to think about is, how do you feel the Holy Spirit moving through you? How do you feel the Holy Spirit moving through your family? Okay, let me turn this off. Okay, let's say a quick little prayer. Hey God, thank you for always being there. Even though we can't see you, we feel your presence like a fan. We know you're there because we see all the awesome things that you do. We hear all the awesome things that you do for us. And we know that you are with us every step of the way. Help us to remember that even though we can't always feel you, you're not going to leave us alone. Thanks for being there with us always. In your name we pray. Amen.
Today's reading is a response reading, and it comes from the second chapter of Acts, verses 1 through 18. On the day of Pentecost, all of Jesus' closest followers were together in one house. Suddenly, from above, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it echoed through the entire house. What looked like individual flames of fire appeared to be dancing among them, with one flame hovering over each person. They were all filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit, empowering them to speak in various languages. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation on pilgrimage in Jerusalem. Hearing the commotion, a bewildered crowd gathered. Strangely, each person in the crowd heard the disciples speaking in their own native language. Amazed and perplexed, they asked,
"Aren't all of these men and women who
Indeed, they were Parthians, Medes, Elamites, along with residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia. Some were from Pontus and Asia, not to mention Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene. There were pilgrims from Rome, both Jews and converted Gentiles. Even some Cretans and Arabs were among them." Many were justifiably bewildered, asking,
"What's going on? How is this even possible?"
Others were less enthralled, rolling their eyes and dismissing it, saying,
"They must have enjoyed too much accessible wine."
Peter went out into the crowded street with the others by his side. He raised his voice and started speaking.
"My Jewish brothers and sisters, and all who live in this holy city, pay close attention to what I'm about to tell you. We are not drunk, as some of you have imagined. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning, and not a one of us has had even a sip of wine. No, this is what was spoken by the Spirit, as God declared through the prophet Joel. In the last days, I will pour out my Spirit upon all humanity. Your daughters and your sons shall prophesy. Your younger women and men will see visions, while your older men and women will dream dreams. Even upon the poor and servant classes of women and men, I will pour out my Spirit, so they shall speak as my truth-telling prophets." Thank you, Debbie. Thank you all for participating. Thank you, Debbie, for that list of names. It's always a good challenge on Pentecost Sunday. I think it was Steve Schoaf who read it last year, but she did great. She did great. Got them all pronounced well and good. Thanks. I always tell the reader, just keep reading. Nobody's going to know the difference, right? Yeah. So do me a favor. Think back to a time when you sometimes, as some of us maybe showing my age a bit, but when you frequented the public library, or at least visited once or twice. My mom was a teacher, elementary school teacher. She made sure my brother and I had library cards while we were in elementary school. We went to the local library twice a month, every month, no matter what. Well, another question. How many of you ever had an overdue book? Anybody? All right, we know what that's like. Did you ever have to pay some fines, late fees on occasion? Well, recently, a man showed up at the public library in St. Helena, California, to return an overdue book. They no longer collect late fees anymore, so he just laid it on the desk, said hello to the staff, and walked out, and got a thank you back from the person who was behind the desk. And she didn't even look at the book until later on, once the man was long gone. You know where I'm going with this, don't you? The book is titled A Family History of the United States, and it was published in 1892. It looks pretty old, and it's falling apart, and it was 96 years overdue. 96 years overdue. A hand-printed note inside the book read, "This book may be kept for up to 2 weeks." And it was checked out, we know, on February 7th, 1927, because the return stamp said February 21, 1927. 96 years and a little bit. Identification numbers on the book indicate it was likely one of the original books in the library's collection when it opened in the 1890s. The total late fees would have been, if they still collected them, $1,700 and some change. Fortunately, he went back when it hit the news, and they didn't make him pay anything. But as I said, they stopped collecting late fees. It was discovered a few weeks ago by a couple cleaning out some old boxes from their Napa Valley homes that had moved with them several times, boxes that had not been opened in a very long time. Apparently, that woman's grandfather was planning to start teaching his daughters about American history when he checked it out. 96 years later, the book still existed after being checked out for 2 weeks. But neither the library staff nor the family of the original patron realized that it existed. It had kind of gotten lost in the shuffle and in life. They were totally surprised by something that was there all along, out of sight and out of mind, you might say, just waiting to be revealed and rediscovered. Now, how many of you heard or remember something, recall Pastor Marty's sermon from last week about the ascension story? You don't have to raise your hands, but think about last Sunday's story of the ascension and the ascension story. Do you remember something that Pastor Marty repeated three times? Let me get that right. Three times in her message. Jesus was talking about the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. He told them to wait, relax, and it will show up. It will be revealed, and then he disappeared. He just disappeared. As Pastor Marty said, they must have had no idea of what was going on and what he was talking about. Because there's that picture of them just staring up into the sky, and a messenger comes by and says, "What are you doing looking up in the sky? What are you looking for?" Jesus, life, God, is down here on earth. And Marty said three different times, there may be a surprise in store. There may be a surprise in store. This story leaves us thinking there may be a surprise that God has in store. Today's Pentecost story is the follow-up story to those confused disciples staring up into the sky as Jesus disappeared. The surprise that God had in store for them, that God has in store for us, is God's Holy Spirit, the gift of God's ongoing and energizing presence in the disciples' lives and, yes, in ours. The Bible story is clear. God's Spirit has been present all along. It was the source of God's breath that created the universe, and then, when the time came, brought the earth into being at the very beginning of our story. It was hovering over the waters and the face of the earth, we are told, as the earth took its shape. The Holy Spirit was the inspiration of the prophets and the Hebrew scriptures who spoke God's demands for justice and God's intention to hold the wealthy accountable for the plight or the lifting up of the poor. And among many other stories, it is God's Spirit that animated Jesus. It is God's Spirit that was the life force at work in the ministry and mission and teachings of Jesus, who constantly forgave the unforgivable, welcomed sinners, fed hungry people, and healed the outcasts so they could be restored to community. The surprise God had in store is like that library book that was 96 years overdue. Jesus had been telling them and showing them the Spirit in his life for their, 3 years or so of ministry together, and they still didn't understand. God's Spirit is still around, still present, and like that library book, still in circulation. But for whatever reasons, we forget too easily and fail to take notice, or just wander off from time to time, or maybe even try to put it in a box. We fail to take notice. We have forgotten that our baptisms promise and our baptisms mean that God's Spirit even lives in us and always lives through us. Peter and the other disciples took a chance. And so they saw a crowd gathering, and they went out into the street and started speaking. They started telling others how God's grace had laid hold of their lives through Jesus, and it wouldn't let them go. And they started, in their own words, in their own ways, saying that. And the Spirit took over from there. They told the story of how Jesus showed them this amazing and powerful love that wasn't just for a few, but for everyone. And a love that makes life worth living, and also a love that makes death a whole lot less scary. They started living the way Jesus taught them to live every day for 3 years. And the same Spirit that gave life to a person named Jesus and a body called Jesus of Nazareth, that same Spirit now brought life to a whole community of people that became known as what? The body of Christ, who we are, the body of Christ. So are we at least willing to keep exploring and looking for another time? Are we willing to hold out the possibility that God continues to surprise us? Are we able to trust in that surprise of God's life-giving Spirit living not just in us and around us, but through us? Enough to keep showing and telling the story of God's grace with our hands, with our feet, with our voices. A longtime First Lutheran member surprised me last week, right after worship ended. She came up to me last week after worship and said, through tears of joy, she said, "Jay, I want to thank you and the other leaders of First Lutheran for the two miracles I saw this morning." "Oh, what do you mean?" I asked. She said, "I never thought I'd see some things again that I witnessed today. I never thought I'd see not just one child, but two children baptized on the same Sunday. And 18 new people join our church." And I must add a little note there. 18 people and Max, the service dog, right? First service dog in our membership. "Thanks be to God," she said, "for those two miracles on the same day." I happened to mention this on the phone with a recently retired Lutheran pastor. He just retired in March. And he said, "Wow, Jay, good for you First Lutheran folk. God must be up to something with all of you. I don't hear many stories like that these days." Maybe there's a surprise God has in store for us. And maybe it, that is, God's Holy Spirit, has been here with us all along. Last thing, Cindy and I just watched a couple of nights ago the recent movie Air. Don't know if any of you have seen it. We enjoyed it. It tells the story of the shoe company Nike getting Michael Jordan to be their spokesperson when he graduated, well, when he left college and went to the pros. There's a piece in there about shoe designer Peter Moore, who created what was a groundbreaking and history-making design called Air Jordans. It became the biggest selling athletic shoe of all time. But he says he never had the opportunity. He said, well, first of all, Peter Moore said he had this feeling. He had this feeling for a long time, just kind of nagging at him and gnawing at him, that this design was inside of him for a long, long time. But he never took the opportunity or had the opportunity to let it out, to let it come out, to let it loose. And in the movie, when he shows the prototype shoe to the colleagues who have to market it and produce it and sell it, and not only that, but also convince Michael Jordan that this is his shoe and he needs this shoe, he says this: "It was so natural. It's like water. It's everywhere. Like the shoe was always here. Like it always existed." And apparently, it was just waiting for someone like Peter Moore and Michael Jordan to bring attention to it. And like Peter Moore, to give themselves fully to it. And then they could show the world. Where's the Holy Spirit in your life, living within you? Are you willing to sometimes take that step? Are we willing to take that step and step out and show and tell a little bit more often, trusting that as we do that, the Spirit will continue to do its thing as we trust that we can do this? So happy Pentecost, people of God. Welcome to God's surprise party. Apparently, the Holy Spirit still has work for us to do. Together, in Jesus' name, amen.
We got a new one today. Please join us in singing Revolutionary. Maybe you're not like me. Maybe we don't agree. Maybe that doesn't mean we gotta be enemies. Maybe we just get brave, take a big leap of faith, call the truth so me and you can find a better way.
Let's take some time, open our eyes, look and listen. First, he would love first. What would
Jesus do. He would love first. He would love first. So we should love first.
Nicely done. Thank you. Thank you. Very nice. Very nice. So let's take our hearts and minds to God and collect our thoughts together as we pray today. Join with me for the response. Let us pray. O God of revolutionary and relentless love, we thank you for the promise of Pentecost, that your spirit, your life force that brought the universe into existence, that brought Moses and your people Israel out of slavery in Egypt, that composed the Psalms and spoke through the prophets, and that gave life and power to the mission and ministry of Jesus. That spirit, that power, that life now lives in us. We are humbled, we are grateful, and help us to be open to your surprising love as you continue to lead us. Lord of the journey, show us the way. We confess that sometimes we see Pentecost as something only in the past. We admit that often we forget that your spirit still breathes life into us every day, giving us the energy and power to embody the love of Christ, especially for those who long for hope and who need good news. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for forgiving us and for renewing this path of purpose we are traveling together. Lord of the journey, show us the way. We call to mind on this Memorial Day weekend those who gave up their lives in service to this nation. As we remember such acts of sacrifice and duty, we pray that you would inspire us and countless others to be grateful as we strive to serve the greater good and to serve others in all that we undertake. Lord of the journey, show us the way. As St. Francis of Assisi once prayed, Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. Lord of the journey, show us the way. Holy Spirit, let your healing presence be and move among us as we pray for those who need your comfort, your healing, and your presence in their journeys. We pray for Betty, Jean, Douglas, Shelley, Shirley, Linda, Peggy, Becky, Julie, Judy, Geneva, Joanne, Colette, Hope, and Larry. Lord of the journey, show us the way. All these things, O God, we pray as we continue to trust that your spirit lives within us and your spirit spoke through our Lord Jesus, who taught us to pray as we pray together now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We take a moment now to prepare for communion. And just a quick word so you know, Art and I, we'll take this side over here, okay, Art? And Susan and Hank will be over here on this side. Art and I will have our masks on in case anybody would prefer to receive from someone with a mask. We're kind of going to do that for a while in this in-between stage and provide that for those. Even if you're in this section and you want a mask, someone with a mask to serve you, come on over. You can go out that back door and come up the aisle if you'd like, however you'd like to do it. Come join us. Thanks. Join with me in the words. The Spirit of God is surely in this place. The presence of God is with us wherever we are. We open our lives to celebrate the Spirit of God revealed in the life of Jesus. We open our hearts to receive the presence of God when bread and wine are shared. Jesus gathered his closest friends and followers for a final meal before his death. During the meal, Jesus lifted bread and gave thanks to God. He broke the bread, sharing it with them, saying, "This is me, this is my body. I'm giving myself away as a gift for one and all. Do this often and remember me." Then he lifted the cup. He gave thanks to God and shared it with them, saying, "This is my lifeblood. I'm pouring it out as a gift of healing, a promise of eternal love for you and for the world. Whenever you do this, remember me." In this meal, we trust Jesus is saying, "The power of God's eternal love now lives in you. The Spirit of my faithful presence now flows through you." In this meal, Jesus reminds us who we are becoming. You are now a part of my body. You and I are one with each other and one with God. You are my heart, my hands, and my voice. You are God's healing grace for the world. Amen. Come join me, communion assistants. Please come forward. Given in love for you.
Amen.
Given in love for you. 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 Sit down here.
Two.
The Holy Spirit is the breath of God that empowered Jesus and now lives in us. I invite you to take a deep breath in and out. We breathe, immersed in divine presence everywhere we go. We breathe, feeling Christ's love connect us with creation and community. We breathe, open to whatever the Spirit leads us. We breathe, expressing gratitude for every moment of life. We breathe, knowing God is always present in all that we do. Amen.
Join us in singing Come Alive, Dry Bones.
Man, it seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off their slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory.
Thanks for being a part of worship. Happy Pentecost to you all. Now go with Christ and go as Christ to love and serve God's world. Thanks be to God.